God took his time to design you the way you are. Put every quality.
Gladness is actually not this world. It's actually living in the supernatural, in the natural.
That Jesus did not live a life to please himself, but what is fitting.
Glory transforming every part of me. That's why I've come to you. That's why I've come. To see your power transforming every part of me. That's why I've come. That's why I've come. To see your glory changing every part of us. That's why we've come, oh Lord. That's why we've come. That's why we've come, oh Lord. That's why we've come.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to another episode of Perspective of the Truth. I know it's been a while. And I'm trusting God that all is well with you, your family, and with all that concerns you, as it's customary to say peace to you, peace to your house, and peace to all that you have. I want to say that again. Peace to you, peace to your house, and peace to all that you have. That is what we say to those who God's grace and mercy has preserved, particularly this period of COVID-19 and the lockdown and everything. We thank God for the grace that he has given to us to gather together once again and to have this opportunity to share the mind and the spirit of God with you this day. Now, I've been meditating for a while, and by the help of the Holy Spirit, the Lord dropped something in my spirit, and I called it the access keys of the kingdom. Things that when we engage can transform our scenarios and our situations and bring us to the context of what God has in store for us. I'm going to be sharing two scriptures to lay the foundation for it, and then I will list the 10 keys for us. I want you, if you still have your Bibles with you, to turn with me to Matthew 6 verse 33. It's a very popular scripture that says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, then every other thing will be added unto you." So I want you to first of all take that as a meditation. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, meaning that the kingdom is penultimate above all things for us to seek as believers and as children of God. And he says every other thing will be added unto you, meaning that when you seek the kingdom, you gain access to every other thing. So how do we access that every other thing? So I want you to hold that thought first. So seeking God's kingdom and his righteousness gives us access to every other thing. Every other thing means every other thing. If there's anything you are believing God for, it's captured in that when you seek that kingdom and his righteousness. But you know, I want you also to understand that it doesn't just stop there. If you go and take the Bible and move to Matthew 16, a very popular scripture of when Jesus got to the region of Caesarea Philippi, and he's asked his disciples, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And then his disciples started saying, "Some said thou art John the Baptist. Some said thou art one of the prophets." It was only Peter that said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus turned to him and said, "Flesh and blood has not revealed this unto you, but my Father who is in heaven." And now says, "Upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." But there was something significant he said in verse 19. And I want to read it. He says, And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, that whatsoever you bind on earth is bound, and whatsoever you loose on earth is loosed. So I want you to understand that the kingdom of God has keys. There are things that we can lay hold on, that when we know them, we can use them to access the every other thing. So that for this particular season of teaching, I'm using those two texts of scripture as the foundation. That is Matthew 6 verse 33 and then Matthew 16 from verses 13 to 19. So I want you to first of all lay that as a foundation. That number one, when we seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, we gain access to every other thing. That is, as in every other thing that we need to fulfill destiny is added unto us. And then Jesus took a step further to talk to Peter and says, I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven, so that whatever you bind on earth is bound and whatsoever you loose on earth is loosed. Because God, in his infinite mercies, wants us as children to operate via revelation. Because you must understand that these keys are not physical keys. They are revealed keys. And I want you to understand that these revealed keys can change your life as it has helped me and helped my family and has changed us and brought us to different levels. And these keys, I was able by the help of the Holy Spirit to access 10 of them. The first key in no particular order is the Word of God. I want you to understand that it's very critical. That Word gives you access to the unlimited potentials of what heaven has in store. That's why he said in John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word. So I'm going to go into detail later, but I want to list out the 10 keys for us to know them, and then we'll go series after series to take one at a time. Precept upon precept, line upon line. So the first key is the Word of God. I'm reading that again. So please take note of that, the Word of God. The second key is love. The second key is love. In 1 John 4:7 and 8, it said, Beloved, let us love one another. For the love is of God, and everyone that loves is born of God and knows God. He that knows not God, he that loveth not, knows not God, because God is love. Love is an access key that brings us into dimensions beyond our expectation. So I want to hold that second thought as a second key. The third key and access into the kingdom is prayer. Luke 18 verse 1 says, Men ought always to pray and never to lose heart. And Jesus said in Matthew 6, when he was teaching his disciples, he taught them the attitude of prayer and he taught them the context of prayer. So I'm going to be going into the attitude and the context of prayer when we get to that third key of prayer. The fourth key is submission. The Bible says, Submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. And many of us do not know that submission is very critical in the kingdom. You need to submit first to God. Secondly, you need to submit to spiritual authority. Thirdly, you need to submit to rulership. And in the family, wives need to submit to husbands. Husbands need to submit to their wives. And we're going to be talking about the language of submission for both parties. And I want you to understand that it is what precedes authority and power. In everything that you do, if you're not willing to submit, you always run foul of authority, you always run foul of power. So you need to understand that submission is also a critical key and access point in the kingdom. The fifth key is hope. Hope, like my pastor will say, hope beyond the scope of human understanding. Without hope, everything in humanity dies out. And somebody once said, it was a quote, that hope is that particular belief that a man begins to see light even in the midst of darkness. So hope is that one thing that does not make you feel ashamed. Hope is that one thing that gives your faith substance. That's why the Bible says faith is the substance of things hoped for, meaning that faith gives hope substance. So when you have faith, your hope is kept alive, even when things don't seem to want to work in the way you expect it. So that number five is hope. Number six is faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. You can't even function in the kingdom if you are not a person of faith. And we're going to be looking at that. And then the seventh one is honor. Honor. My brothers and my sisters, it is a system the kingdom operates by. If I be your father, in Malachi chapter 1, he said, where's my honor? If I be a master, he said, where's my reverence? And the Bible makes it clear in 1 Samuel 2 verse 30. It says, those that honor me, I will honor. And those that lightly esteem me, I will disdain. So honor is something that when we operate by, it gives us grace to be able to do so many things. Honor your father and your mother is the first commandment with promise. And it will be well with you and you will live long. Listen to me. Many people are dying because they do not understand the concept and the access key of honor. And I'm going to be looking at that as the seventh thing. The eighth one is humility. The Bible says, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God so that in due time, he would exalt you. Promotion comes by humility. Jesus humbled himself and was subject to God. And when it pleased God, he exalted him and gave him a name that was above every other name. That at the mention of the name of Jesus, every knee must bow and every tongue must confess to the glory of God the Father. The ninth key is the Holy Spirit. It's the one we cannot do without. Jesus told the disciples in Acts chapter 1, wait for the promise of the Father. The Holy Spirit is that promise, that seal unto the day of redemption that gives us the access into the knowers of God, into the nuances of God. He's the one that energizes us with the giftings of the Spirit and makes the natural supernatural, or makes the supernatural natural for us. When we have the Holy Spirit, we're able to access the supernatural naturally. And then, of course, the 10th key is worship. Worship and praise. I'm looking forward to that one, because Bible says that God is looking for those who will worship Him in spirit and in truth. How did worship become something that God is looking for? It's because true worship is not common. Worship starts first as a song, as a journey of obedience. In Genesis 22, the Bible makes it clear that Abraham said, "I and the lad will go yonder to worship the Lord." Worship is a journey of obedience. Worship starts with obedience. You can't worship God if you're not willing to obey Him. So these 10 keys are the ones I'm going to be looking at in this series of access keys to the kingdom. These access keys helps you and I to function effectively in the kingdom in order to be able to lay hold on all the other things that the Lord has given to us. So without wasting much time, I'm going to just take one key because of our time. That first key is the Word of God. The Word of God in John 1:1. John chapter number 1, verses 1. John, the book of John. So if you have your Bibles with me, please quickly turn with me to John chapter number 1, verse number 1. I say John chapter number 1, verses 1 to 4, and then I'm going to read verse 14 and quickly round off because of our time. It says, "In the beginning was the Word." So the first thing I want you to understand because of time is that the Word creates a new beginning. Every one of us in the kingdom starts a new season with the Word of God. When the Word of the Lord comes to you, it creates a new season. It says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God." So every word that comes to you actually abides with God. So it creates a new beginning. It gives an abiding record. That word was with God, and that word abides with God. And the Bible says again that that word was God. So God and His word are the same, and we must understand that the Word of God is not just the written book that you have here. The Word of the Lord is everything He speaks to you in the place of intimacy and koinonia and fellowship with Him. The Word of the Lord is everything that the Lord speaks to you. But most of the time, many of the things that God has said is witnessed in the Scriptures. And whenever we go into the Scriptures, we are able to pick the mind of God, we are able to pick the Spirit of God, and we are able to speak the directions of God concerning any matter. So when the Word of the Lord comes to you, it changes your perspective and it gives you God's own perspective in the life of others of what He would want you to do, particularly about any issue. He says, "And the Word was with God, and the Word was God." He was in the Word with God. He was in the beginning with God. So the Word of God is a He, is a personality. So there's the written Word and there's the living Word. The Word of the Lord is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the dividing soul and spirit, bone and marrow, and it's a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of a man's heart. So that word, or the Word of God, is a discerner, is a person, is what changes everything. If there's anything you want to do, ask yourself, just like my wife would say, chapter what, verse what? What verse, what chapter? If it's not written, it is not doable. If it's not written, it can never be done. I would never forget. We waited for 7 years before God gave us children at the seventh, going into the 8th year, the 8 years in total. And one of the years when we were waiting, somebody came to us, which was my our landlord at that time. He came to us and he said, okay, that he has been praying, and he brought a prophet. And the prophet said, "I know that you are pastors, I know that you are believers, that he wants us to be spiritual." And he defines spiritual as spirit plus ritual. So he said that you are doing spiritual things, but you need to do the ritual aspects. And I remember my wife telling him and asking him a question, where is it written? That if he can show us where it's written in the Bible, then she would be willing to do anything he says. Because today, I thank God for the mercy of God, that God did not allow us out of desperation to yield to the pressures of men and violate the concept of the Scripture. Because today, we will not have an opportunity to lift up holy hands and say, "God, come and take all the glory." But we thank God for his mercy and his grace that today he has given us the opportunity. And if you read on, he says, in him was the word, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. So the word of God has life. The word of God has light. And you know, in him was life, and the light was the light of men. And that light shines in the midst of darkness, and the darkness cannot comprehend it. It means that the darkness cannot comprehend the power of the word of God. And last but not the least, you will see in verse number 14, and the word became flesh and dwelt amongst us. So the word of God can dwell and become flesh. And that's where I want you to come into, to access the potential of the word available in the kingdom. Embrace the word and let the word of God be your everyday guide and guardian. So let the person of the word, let the written word, let the spirit of the word, and let the conversion power of the word come upon you, take on your flesh, and give you all that is needed and needful in such a time like this. Thank you as you have listened to the first one. I'm going to come your way again with the next one. And when I come your way to the next one, I trust God that it will not only change you, it will transform you, and it will bring you to that place that God wants you to be. Till I come your way again for part two, God bless you. God keep you. God cause his face to shine upon you mightily in Jesus' name. Don't forget, access keys to the kingdom that will allow us to gain access to every other thing that God has in store for us in Jesus' name. God bless you.